Are you guys able to see my screen? Yeah, are you guys able to see?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we will start with gravitation today and do a few problems which I've shared with you. So unlike the previous chapter, this is a small one. Okay. And this chapter is similar to the concept of electrostatics that you're learning this year. So, in this chapter, gravitation, what is our main concept of interest? So, what is that we concentrate on? So, this one you people know already, right? So, in this chapter, gravitation, what are all the concepts that we are going to learn? It mainly speaks about how the particles in the universe get attracted towards each other. So, it mainly speaks about this concept. Each object in the universe attracts every other object with a force which is equal to the force of gravitation, right? And from this, we have a concept called as Newton's law of gravitation. If the force of gravitation is existing, then how is it going to exist? Then it is stated like this. The gravitational force is attractive force between two masses. My question is, how are the masses supposed to be? So Newton's law of gravitation speaks about what kind of masses? We will just try to connect the dots. If I ask you to state Coulomb's law, how will you state?
Oh, sir, point masses, sir.
Yes. So between two point masses, M1 and M2, separated by distance r. Okay. And how is the force actually going to act? The force of attraction between them, that is a gravitational force of attraction between them, is directly proportional to the product of the masses and inversely proportional to the square of the distance of separation between them. So when you remove and introduce the constant of proportionality, it will be g m1 m2 divided by r square, where the value of g is how much? It is 6.67 into 10 power minus 11 Newton meter square per kilogram square. Right? So this is a known fact and there is a known theorem. Right? Now, what can you say about the value of capital G? So the value of capital G, is it a universal constant or will it vary from place to place?
Universal constant.
It's a universal constant. So whether you do this, you do an experiment of force of attraction between the objects in our planet or in some other planet or in any other part, its value is still going to be the same, which is 6.67 into 10 power minus 11 Newton meter square per Coulomb square, right? And its dimensional formula is given as m minus 1 L3 t minus 2. See, all these small things will be applicable for other competitive exams. Okay. Now, see, what are all the important points related to gravitational force? This will help us to solve the problems, right? So, one is gravitational force is a central force as well as a conservative force. So, what do you mean by central force, guys? What is meant by central force? If we have two masses, M1 and M2, then there is going to be a force of attraction between them, right? Now the question is force a vector or a scalar quantity? The answer is, it's a vector quantity, right? So if force is a vector quantity, what is the direction in which the force is supposed to act between these two objects? What would be the answer? It will always act along the line joining these two charges. right? So we know this fact. So the forces which are acting along the line joining both the masses is what is called as a central force. Okay, next. It is the weakest force in nature. Third, it is 10 power 36 times smaller than the electrostatic force and 10 power 38 times smaller than the nuclear force. So all these electrostatic force and nuclear force you have learned this year. Electrostatic force in the first chapter, nuclear force in the 13th chapter. Okay. Next, the law of gravitation is applicable for all bodies irrespective of their size, shape and position. Okay. Next, the gravitational force that is acting between the sun and the planet will provide the necessary centripetal force for the planet to revolve around the sun. That is for the orbital motion. We will use it in the concept of orbital velocity. At that time, we will see. Next, Newton's law of gravitation holds good for the force of gravitation. It means the gravitational force between two bodies are action-reaction pairs. In the sense, if you call this as an action pair, then this will be a reaction pair. What is the other action-reaction pair that we have discussed till now? In mechanics, what are all the other action-reaction pairs that we have discussed? If an object is suspended by a string, then what force is exerted by the string?
Tension.
So, tension is also an action-reaction pair. Similarly, friction is also normal. An action-reaction. Yeah, normal is just a reaction force. Action-reaction force means the same magnitude of force should act on both the objects, on two different objects in the different directions. That's what we call it as action reaction.
Sir, adhan gravity and normal reaction is there, no sir?
It is not acting on the same object, no.
Oh, okay, okay.
Okay. Normal is just a reaction force, okay? Don't call it as action reaction. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. So next, there are some important points regarding the gravitational force. One is, unlike the electrostatic force, it is independent of the medium between the particles. Because G never speaks about medium. Whereas when you write Coulomb's law, K speaks about medium, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. This epsilon naught is the permittivity of free space. It keeps changing, right? Because we introduce a concept of dielectric constant. Here, there is nothing like that. Next is, it is conservative in nature. What do you mean by conservative, guys? What is conservative?
Round trip is zero.
Yes, work done in round trip is zero. And there is another important property of a conservative force. What is it? Work done by a conservative.
Take it.
Yes, it is independent of the path in which you carry the object from one place to another. So these are all important points. Have it in your mind. So it expresses the force between two point masses of negligible volume. However, for extended objects of spherical bodies, the whole mass can be assumed to be concentrated at its center of mass. So if you have a symmetrical object, then you can treat it like a point object by considering its center of mass and solving the problems. That we will see when we are doing the problems, okay? So that's what central force is given again. Central force is the force which acts along the line joining towards the centers of the interacting bodies. A central force is always directed towards the center as away from a fixed point. So the other example for central force is electrostatic force also. They will act along the line joining both the charges. Okay. Next is acceleration due to gravity. It is G. And its value is 9.8 meter per second square on the surface of Earth. Right? So, now the question is, how will you calculate the acceleration due to gravity on the surface of the Earth at a height and at a depth? So, you can make a note of all these points. Acceleration due to gravity, G. Yeah, tell me guys. So if I take an object on the surface of the Earth, then how do I calculate the acceleration due to gravity on the surface? Mg will be equal to what? Mg is the weight of the object. G into small m into capital M, which is mass of Earth, divided by what is this distance? This is R E. So R E square. M and M will get cancelled. So small g will be capital G into M E divided by R E square. Right. So if you substitute, you look at this, all are constants. If you substitute the value of all those parameters, you will get the answer as 9.8 meter per second square. This is on surface of Earth or very close to surface of Earth. Right? So what will happen at an altitude? So if this is RE and this is H, then how will the acceleration due to gravity vary with altitude?
So it inversely vary.
Yeah, what is the expression? Huh? How will you derive it?
G ME by RE plus H, the whole square.
Okay. So how did you get that? Let's say the acceleration due to gravity is g dash at a height h. So m into g dash will be the weight of the new weight of the object. And this m into g dash should be equal to g into
re plus h the whole square.
Re plus h the whole square. That's it. It's a simple logic. Left hand side should be mg. Right hand side should be Newton's law of gravitation. So g dash will be equal to g into me divided by re plus h the whole square. Okay. So this is one of the formulae. This is when you have appreciable height or appreciable altitude. In the sense, it is not a comparative one. The altitude is also on a comparative scale with the radius of the Earth. For example, when they say the height of the object, the altitude to which the object is lifted is half of the radius of the Earth, then we will use this formula. Sometimes what will happen is the value of H will be very much less than RE. Okay, it will not be approximately zero, but it will be on a very small. It will be a very small value compared to the radius of the Earth. At that time, what we need to do is G dash will be equal to, observe what I'm going to do is, from this expression, GME divided by, if I take out RE outside, it will become RE square plus 1 divided by HE, sorry, 1 plus HE, H by RE the whole square. Right? So what is this GME by R square, guys? It is small g divided by 1 plus H by RE the whole square. Right? Can I write this as g into 1 plus h by re the whole power minus 2? G into, when the value of h is very much less than re, then h by re is very much less than 1. When this happens, then 1 plus x the whole power n for magnitude of x to be very much less than 1 is what? Is equal to 1 plus nx. According to the binomial theorem concept, so here it will be 1 minus 2h divided by re. This is the value of g dash. Okay, make a note of this point. Done?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now the next is acceleration due to gravity at depth D. So let's say an object is placed at a depth D below the surface of the earth. Then M into G double dash in this case will be equal to how much? Capital G into mass of the small object into the mass of the earth, which is concentrated at the center. And how much is this distance now, guys?
Re minus D.
Re minus D. Okay. There is a mistake in the equation that I have written. Correct it. I'll give you a hint. There is a mistake on the right side in the numerator.
The mass of the earth.
Yes. In the previous two cases, what happened is the object was either on the surface or above the surface of the earth. So the whole mass of the earth was responsible to pull it towards the center. But here, only this much mass is contributing to the acceleration due to gravity. That is the force, right? The mass which is present in the small sphere is definitely not going to be the total mass of the earth. Rather, it will be a value which is less than that, which I'll call it as ME dash. How to find that ME dash? That is, you will assume the earth to be a sphere. So what is the density of earth? It is the mass of the earth divided by 4 by 3 pi into Re cube. When it is uniform, then what will be the density of the smaller portion? That will be ME dash divided by 4 by 3 pi into Re minus D the whole cube. Right? So since both left hand sides are rho, I can write M by 3, 4, ME divided by 4 by 3 pi Re cube is equal to ME dash divided by 4 by 3 pi Re minus D the whole cube. This and this will get cancelled. What is the value of ME dash? So ME into 1 minus D by Re the whole cube. Take this value, substitute it here. Actually, we can leave it as it is because Re minus D the whole cube will get cancelled. So let's take this value and substitute it in the first equation. Guys, are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So M into G double dash will be equal to G M into ME into Re minus D the whole cube divided by Re cube the whole divided by Re minus D the whole square. Right. So this and one value will get cancelled. Small m is gone. So G double dash will be equal to G M E divided by Re cube into Re minus D. What we can do is I'll write this as Re square divided by Re. Right. What is this value, guys? It is small g into 1 minus D divided by Re. So this is the value of G double dash at a depth D. Right. So the first set of problems that we are going to discuss will be based on acceleration due to gravity. I'm not able to hear. Did someone speak?
Yes, sir. Can you scroll up a little bit?
Yeah. Is this fine?
No, sir. Just like the last page. That's it.
Just like?
The last page. The last page.
This one?
Yes, sir.
Oh. Okay. then
yes sir.
Okay. Now see, let's do some problems based on this concept. So the topic one that we discussed is gravitational force and acceleration due to gravity. Let's see how to deal with problems. So look at the first question. The ratio of weights of an object on the Earth's surface so that to that on the surface of a planet is 9:4. The mass of the planet is 1/9 of that of the Earth. If R is the radius of the Earth, what is the radius of the planet? How to do this, guys? Who can tell me? So mg divided by mg dash is equal to 9/4. But what is mg? Gm into mass of Earth divided by the radius of Earth square divided by gm into mass of the planet divided by the radius of planet the whole square, that is equal to 9/4. So g into m will get cancelled. Mass of Earth divided by radius of Earth square into the radius of planet divided by the mass of planet is equal to 9/4. Now tell me, guys. Mass of the planet is 1/9 of that. Radius of the Earth, what is the radius of the planet? So mass of the planet is 1/9 times that of Earth. So if the radius of Earth is R, did anyone complete it? Is equal to 9/4. So 9 will go to the numerator. 9 times Rp square is equal to 9R square divided by 4. So Rp will be equal to R/2. Right? Is there anyone who didn't understand what I did? So it's a simple problem. Shall I move on to the next one?
Yes, sir.
You guys try the next one. The time dependence of the position of a particle of mass m is equal to 2 is given by, the position vector is given, 2t I cap minus 3t square j cap. Its angular momentum with respect to the origin at time t is equal to 2s. Actually, I don't know why they have asked us in gravitation, but okay. Since they are asking about angular momentum, try to find out this. So for us to calculate angular momentum, what is the required parameter? I think we have done this problem, right, in angular momentum itself.
Mass, velocity, and position vector.
Okay, find it out. So, what is the work you need to do? Can you tell me the steps to be followed to solve this problem? Mass is given. So, they are asking the angular momentum with respect to origin at t is equal to 2, means they are asking the instantaneous acceleration. Right? Oh, sorry, instantaneous angular momentum. So, for that, you need instantaneous velocity. So what is the instantaneous velocity, guys? How will you find it?
dr by dt.
So how much are you going to get? dr by dt is going to give you 2 minus 60. That is 2 I cap. Don't forget the vectors, okay? 2 I cap minus 60 j cap. Then what are you supposed to do? Take t is equal to 2 and substitute it here. You will have 2 I cap minus 12 j cap. This is the velocity vector. What about the position vector, guys? for position vector, take 2 and directly substitute it here. Yes, 4i cap minus
12j.
Okay. So you have velocity vector, radius vector, and mass. So since you have them in vector format, it will be m into r vector cross v vector. Don't do v minus v cross r. Fortunately, there are no answers which are negative and positive of each other. See, for example, what they will do is sometimes they'll give you 36 k cap and minus 36 k cap. What will happen when you use r cross v, you will get 36 k cap. When you use v cross r, you will get minus 36. Since you did the mistake, you will take minus 36 and come. That will be wrong. So be careful with the order. Can you do it fast and tell me? So what is the answer, guys? Is still doing. Is it tough? So M into
minus 48k cap.
That's right. Is it minus 48k? Minus 48k cap is the right answer. I think that we did this problem in the last time. I remember this answer. Anyways, so this doesn't belong to gravitation, but that's fine. The answer is minus 48k cap, guys. If you don't get it, let me know. Let's do the next one. The value of acceleration due to gravity at Earth's surface is 9.8 meters per second square. The altitude above its surface at which its acceleration due to gravity decreases to 4.9 meters per second square is close to what value? If you observe, see, when it comes to altitude, right, there are two formulae. What are they? G dash is equal to one of the formula which I told you is GMA divided by RE plus H the whole square, right? I will just manipulate this and show you. GMA divided by, can I take out RE outside? It will become RE square into 1 plus H by R the whole square. What is GMA divided by R square, guys? It is small g divided by 1 plus H by RE the whole square. Can I call this as one of the formula, or G dash is equal to G into 1 minus 2H divided by RE. Okay. When are we going to use the second one? When the value of H is?
Very small.
Very small. Okay. When the value of H is very small, you can use this formula, because when you use it, you will get a value which is very close to 9.8. Means if I ask you what is a fractional change, what do you mean by fractional change, guys? Fractional changes, see, not only in this chapter, wherever you, this is a repeatedly asked question, okay? Fractional change or percentage change, they'll keep asking like this. So what do you mean by fractional changes? Final minus initial divided by initial. If you take it like this, this is the fractional change. Please make a note of it. That is, you're doing a comparative study of the change. See, final minus initial is only change. Try to understand the naming structure. Final minus initial is only change. Whereas, final minus initial divided by initial is called as fractional change. And if you multiply that with 100, we call it as percentage change. Right? This is how the naming structure goes in physics. Now comes an important question. Since the acceleration due to gravity has two formulae, if in the question they would have given me height, I can do a comparative study because h is very much less than re, then I can use this formula. If it is not less, then I would have used the first one. Guys, are you able to understand how? I'm just sharing the idea to think. But in this question, what have they done? They have not given you the height. Rather, our work is to find height. But what else have they given? They have given the new acceleration due to gravity, which is 4.9 meters per second square. So if I ask you, how much decrease in value has taken place in terms of percentage, what will you say?
50%.
50%. So 50%, is it an ignorable value? So 50% change, 50% change should take place means the object should have moved to an observable height. So in this case, what I'm indirectly trying to say is you need to use the first formula. Is my explanation? Did you understand what I'm trying to say? If you use the second formula and look for the answers, maybe they would have given that option also and you will tick that. That is going to be a wrong method. No. So, I will use g dash is equal to g divided by 1 plus h by re the whole square. So, what I can do is 1 plus h by re the whole square will be equal to g divided by g dash. So, if at the surface the height is the acceleration due to gravity is g, and at certain height it is g by 2. So, g and g will get cancelled, it will be 2. It is 1 plus h by re the whole square. Don't expand and do these problems. You should take the square to the other side and the numbers which are known to the right hand side. So, 1 plus h by re will be equal to root 2. That is 0.4. So h will be equal to 0.4 into re. Radius of Earth is 6.4. 6.4 into 0.4. Last number should be. So 64 into 4 is how much? 16. Should be 2.6 into 10 power 6. Guys, are you able to understand?
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Got it, right? Good. Okay, one more common mistake that will happen is, since this has got decreased to half, many people think it will be 3.2. 3.2 will not come because the acceleration due to gravity is not linearly proportional. It is rather proportional square times. Okay, there's the answer. Shall I move on?
Yes, sir.
Next one is theory only. The variation of acceleration due to gravity g with distance d from the center of the earth is best represented by. So as you move away from the center of the Earth to the surface and again from there to a certain altitude, how is the value of G going to vary? So we will write down G is equal to G into 1 minus D divided by R. For the value of R, similarly, it will be G when the value of R is less than R, when the value of R is equal to R, when the value of R is greater than R, then it is G divided by 1 plus H by R the whole square. So you guys tell me which one is right. So first one mathematically represents what function?
Straight line.
So it's a straight line. So it should be a straight line. Then it will attain a maximum value, a constant value G. After that, it is inversely proportional to R square. So it follows a parabolic path. Guys, are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So try the, this is an advanced one. Let's not worry about this. Don't worry. Do the sixth one. If the radius of the Earth were to shrink by 1%, its mass remaining the same, the acceleration due to gravity on the Earth's surface would be. So here they are not asking the mathematical values. They are just asking what is going to happen to the acceleration. So G is equal to Gm divided by R square.
So will it increase?
Yes. That's it. Okay, increase. Okay, 1 minute. So you will have these kind of problems alone from acceleration due to gravity. If you want, I'll give you some more problems for practice. You can try them. The next concept that we are going to discuss is field strength, potential, potential energy, and escape velocity. Okay. So this is also similar, guys, similar to what we have discussed in electrostatics, right? So if I ask you gravitational field strength, what will you say?
Sir, is it Gmm by R?
That is potential. Oh no, see, if I ask you what is electric field strength, what will you say? Electric field strength is nothing but electric field intensity. Oh, due to a point, sir. Sorry, da?
Gm by R square?
Yes, that's right. So electric field intensity due to a point charge is kq by R square, where k is the constant, q is the charge of the point mass, and r is the distance from the point mass. Similarly, gravitational field strength is given by what? So I can still call it as E for notation. So gravitational field will be G into mass divided by R square. Okay. The concept is very simple. If I ask you to define electric field strength, see, this is the mathematical value. If I ask you to define electric field strength or electric field intensity, how will you do it? how did you actually get kq by r square?
Force acting on a unit discharge.
Yes, force acting on a unit positive discharge. There we have something like positive and negative charges. So E, you got it as the amount of force that is existing between the source charge and the discharge divided by the magnitude of the source charge. That's why we call it as unit positive. Right? In a similar context, what do you think will gravitational field strength be? It is the amount of force. Yes. It is the amount of gravitational force that is acting on a source mass. See, the mass is the one, or you can say test mass, the one which is used for the testing process, F divided by M. So if there is a mass capital M and small m, okay, wait, I will change this to capital M. Then if I call this as the source mass, if I call this as the test mass, okay, why we generally use test is to understand the strength of the other one. See, I'll explain it in a language, in a simpler way. If I have to see the strength of a magnet, what is the easier way to speak about the strength of a magnet? How will I know? Okay, I'll give you a comparative study. If I give you two magnets, I'm giving you two bar magnets. I'm asking you which one is a stronger magnet. Logically, what testing will you do? This is basic common. You will take it to some metal object. Let's say you have door and you have a holder. You will just take it to the metal object. You will see which one is getting attracted more. Right? So what operation you're doing is called as a testing, because you're trying to test the strength. So this is the source which is actually generating the magnetic field. So for testing, you're using a metal object, right? So that is going to speak about the strength of this magnet. Similar is the case here. When you say, when you use the word strength or intensity, you have a source mass. You're going to find the strength which the source mass is able to attract other masses. That is why you need test. The same logic is applicable even for electrostatics. Okay, if they both are separated by distance r, we are going to find out how good the source mass is able to attract. In this case, only attract. Whereas in the case of electrostatics, it is both attract and ripple. Correct? So E will be equal to G capital M into small m divided by the distance square divided by the test mass. So GM divided by R square. Okay, that is what is gravitational field strength. Now, the next question is, how will you define gravitational potential energy?
The amount of work done by an external agent to bring an object from infinity to a point in the gravitational field.
That's right. So gravitational potential energy. So how do you define gravitational potential? You have a source mass. Okay. So around the source mass, there will be an invisible region, which we call it as gravitational field, right? You have a test mass M outside. So any point outside the gravitational field is what is called as infinity, right? This is also a known factor. So this is called as infinity. So if you bring the test mass from infinity to some distance r within the gravitational field by using an external force, then that work which is done will get stored in the form of gravitational potential energy. Now, question is, what is the value of it?
MGH.
MGH is when it is on the surface of the earth. That is derived in a completely different concept. There we use the word work done is equal to force into displacement. Force is Mg, displacement is H. That is why we write MGH. So try to understand the context. This is also called as gravitational potential energy. Not denying the fact.
Minus G mm by
R. So minus G into mm divided by R. The question is, how did we get it? We need to understand that, right? See, try to understand the logic. Here I'm explaining the derivation, because here we are going to derive it using the work done by variable force, right? So what are the two formulae for work? F into S into cos theta when the force is constant. Whereas if the force is varying, then you write it as integral of F dx from where to where, x1 to x2. Correct? Now comes an important question. Let's say at some instant, it is the mass is at a distance x from the source mass. The test mass is at a distance x from the source mass within the gravitational field. So at that instant, what is the force that is acting? Fg will be equal to g capital M into small m divided by x square, accepted. So this gravitational force is a function of x, means it's a variable force. Now comes another question. So if Fg is acting in this direction, in which direction are we supposed to apply the external force? You will be applying it in the opposite direction. So I will write Fe. Here E doesn't stand for, okay, I'll write E, F external. Now what should be the value of F external, guys? It should be slightly greater than Fg, but it can be approximated to g capital M into small m divided by x square. So that, why are we doing this actually? I want you to understand the logic.
Just to oppose the force due to gravity.
Yeah. Right. So if I do these two things, then I have another question. Isn't the object supposed to be at equilibrium?
So F external is slightly greater than.
Yes, that is important. So it is slightly greater, but what we are trying to do here is note this important point, okay? Whenever you are trying to calculate the potential energy, okay, when force is acting, the object will tend to accelerate. When the object is tending to accelerate, it will have a velocity associated with it. So when you want to calculate the potential energy in any such scenario, you need to ensure that the object is moving as slow as possible so that there is no involvement of kinetic energy. That is a major reason. Okay, so you're applying an external force in order to ensure that the object is moved as slow as possible. And let's say it has slightly got displaced by a distance dx. Then what is the small amount of work that is done to displace the object through a distance dx? I'm asking about F work external. Done by x. Yes. F external.
Into dx.
So when I integrate it, so what is the value of F external? G capital M into small m divided by x square into dx from infinity to R. So it will be G capital M into small m into integral of dx divided by x square from infinity to R. How much is it going to be? Integral of 1 by x square is minus 1 by x. It will be minus x from where to where? From infinity to R. Be minus g capital M into small m divided by the same logic we are going to apply for electrostatics also. That's it.
Sir, I have a doubt in the diagram.
Yeah, tell me.
Can you show the diagram? So, like, if it's the work done by the external force to bring the object into the field, then why is it acting in the opposite direction?
I'm just taking this thing. I'm just taking the magnitude of the force external writing it. What are you trying to say? You're saying this is in this direction and dx is in this direction.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So here I'm trying to take the object close from you. Like, this is similar to this context. I know what you're in. What is confusing you? See, if I have an object and I'm pulling it with a force of 5 Newton, okay? And let's say there is a frictional force of 4 Newton acting. And let's say this object has got displaced by a distance, displaced through a distance of x. Okay, when I say it has got displaced through a distance x, then if I ask you what is the work done by friction, what would you say? You will call it as 4 into, how much did I say the distance is? 2 up. You will write it as cos 180, right? Same context for you. Yeah. Same logic I apply. You are trying to say that the external force is greater, then how is the object able to move in the direction dx, right? This is theoretically being taken. That's practically not possible. It is taken theoretically.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Or if you want, what we can do is we can say work done by the gravitational force also. It is the work done by the gravitational force, which is going to be minus G into M into capital M divided by motor, right? But here, one important point you need to concentrate is this minus sign. So gravitational potential energy, whenever you are using it in the problem, you need to always use the minus sign provided. Okay, you need to use a minus sign. I'll tell you, when we apply it, I'll tell you. Okay, so this is gravitational potential energy. Then what is gravitational potential? It's similar to electrostatic potential, amount of work done by unit charge. Here it will be work done by unit mass. So it will be minus capital G into M divided by R. This is the gravitational potential. So what else is the other concept that you need to see? Escape velocity. So what do you mean by escape velocity?
So the velocity required by the satellite to just put into its orbit.
May not be satellite. No. Satellite should not be given an escape velocity. If it is given escape velocity, then how is it going to monitor us? It's not about satellite.
So is it is any other object?
It will talk about any other object, right? So escape velocity on the Earth is the minimum velocity that we need to give to any object. So that what will happen to it? It will escape out of the gravitational pull provided by the Earth, right? So how to calculate its value is? So how to find its, how to find the escape velocity? Is there anyone who is not able to understand what I told? So escape velocity is, as the name suggests, you need to give the velocity to an object, the minimum velocity that is imparted to an object on the surface of the Earth. If I say Earth, I'm talking about the escape velocity of the object from the surface of the Earth. That's the only difference. If it is some other planet, the value of mass will change. So if suppose there is an object on the surface of the Earth, you give it a velocity Ve, then what should the value of Ve be equal to? It's a very simple point. What is the total energy on the surface?
Mgh.
No, no, no. See. Okay. This is mass. This is RE. And the mass of the Earth is concentrated here. Okay. So what is the total energy present on the total mechanical energy? Rather, I'll put a question like this. It is nothing but the kinetic energy of the particle because it's given velocity plus the gravitational potential energy.
Sir, will the expression be minus GMM by 2R?
Let's see. So what is the kinetic energy? Half
of mv square.
V e square. It is not minus that value, whatever you told. That will not come. Because our work is to find escape velocity. You know, why would you convert everything in terms of mass and radius?
No, sir. I'm talking about total energy only.
If you do that, then what will you write the final energy as? There will not have, no, because we have no information about what is going to be the velocity of the object after it escapes the gravitational pull.
Yes, sir.
Are you able to understand why you are not supposed to use it?
Okay, sir.
Okay, because we are talking about the escape velocity is happening on the surface of the Earth. Never do that mistake. Plus, the gravitational potential energy, I told you, it is minus gm into small m, that is minus g into small m into me divided by re. Does it make sense, guys? Why did I write re? Is because I treated the whole mass of the Earth to be concentrated at its center. And the distance between the smaller mass and the mass of the Earth is RE. Does this expression make sense? Are you guys able to understand what I wrote? Can I proceed to the next step?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, what about the total energy at infinity? Infinity in the sense, after it has escaped out of the gravitational pull. The answer is going to be very simple. It is... zero. Right, because gravitational potential energy at infinity is considered to be zero. When I say escape velocity, I'm trying to say the object has reached the maximum height possible. At maximum height, what will happen? Its velocity will be instantaneously zero. So it doesn't have kinetic energy nor the gravitational potential. That is what is going to happen. So since this is a conservative force, since gravitational force is conservative in nature, can I say that the mechanical energy at the surface is conserved? So, half mve square minus g capital M into, g small m into me divided by re is equal to zero. Can I write it like this? Then what will happen? Half mve square is equal to g capital me into small m divided by re. So small m is gone, which implies VE will be equal to root of 2G into ME divided by RE. This is the formula, guys. Or I can write it as root of 2G ME divided by RE square into RE. What is this value, guys?
G.
Small g.
Acceleration due to gravity into RE. This is another formula. Depending on what is given in the question, you can use either of them. Sometimes they will give the density also. Suppose they have not given you the mass of the Earth. They want the answer in terms of density. Then the other way we can write is rho is equal to ME divided by 4 by 3 pi RE cube. Then what will be the value of ME? 4 by 3 pi RE cube multiplied with rho. Right, then what I can do is I can write escape velocity as root of, I used it in this formula, 2 into g divided by RE into 4 by 3 pi RE cube into rho. So RE will cancel this once. So you will have root of 8 rho, or I will write it like this, 8 pi g rho into re square divided by 3, right? 8 pi g rho re square divided by 3. I'll not suggest you to remember this like a formula, but I'm just sharing the idea of how you can derive it on spot. Okay, what you can remember is this one and this one. Am I clear, guys?
ஒரே நிமிஷம் அந்த பேஜ் காட்டுறீங்களா?
Yes, sure.
ஆ, தேங்க் யூ சார்.
Shall we do some problems based on it? Now, let's see. So, a spaceship orbits around a planet at a height of 20 km from its surface. So, remember, if an object has to be in an orbit around any planet, okay, then what is the necessary force?
Centripetal.
The centripetal force. Okay, centripetal force is commonly mv squared by r only. That will be provided by, in this context, that will be provided by whom?
Gravitational force of attraction.
Yes, the gravitational force of attraction. I'm just sharing the idea, so because I saw the word orbit. Assuming that only gravitational field of the planet acts on the spaceship, what would be the number of complete revolutions made by the spaceship in 24 hours around the planet? Let's try to calculate it. A spaceship orbits around a planet at a height of 20 km from its surface. Accepted. Assuming that only gravitational field of the planet acts on the spaceship, what would be the number of complete revolutions made by it in 24 hours? First, tell me, how do we approach? What idea are you getting? See, most importantly, these kind of problems come in the exam, right? Wherever numbers are involved, I'll suggest you to do it at the end only. But since we are discussing the concept, we will try to understand how to solve. This problem is definitely not going to be a small one because you'll have a lot of calculations involved. Tell me how to approach. So they have given time. They have given height of the spaceship from the surface of the Earth. Okay.
Sir, you can equate the gravitational force and the centripetal force.
Okay, by doing that, what are we achieving?
Sir, you can find the velocity at which...
Okay, once you find the velocity, how is it going to help us to solve this problem? What you're saying is right, proceed. But think, by calculating the velocity, how is it going to help us to solve this problem? Because they are asking us something related to the number of revolutions using what data? Using time. How will you calculate the time taken by the object to complete one revolution? What is the data that we need? Varun, are you able to understand my question?
Yes. So, the circumference of the orbit.
Yes, that's right. See, there is a concept called as time period, right? Okay. So, I'll give you an option. I'll tell you a small question. Let's say there is a center and let's say that there is a circular track on which a car is revolving. For which I am saying its time period is 1 hour. I don't know what is the radius of the track and all those things. I'm saying the time period of the car is 1 hour. If I ask you how many revolutions has it completed in 12 and a half hours, what will you do? Okay, I'll change the data. If I say the time period of the car is 2 hours, what is the meaning of this? The car is taking 2 hours to complete one complete revolution. Means if it has started at point P, after 2 hours, if you see, it will still be at the point P. Now my question is, how many revolutions it would have completed in 12 and a half hours? If I ask you a question like this, what are you going to say? So it will be 12.5 divided by 2. Your answer will be 6.25. So it would have completed 6 complete revolutions and 1/4 revolution. Means it would have been somewhere over here. Provided, I'm assuming the object is revolving in anti-clockwise direction. So after 6 revolutions, in 12 and a half hours, you can find the car to be at point P dash. Similar is the context here. Except the fact that time period is not given. So your work is to find the time period. So you're able to understand, you have to do the reverse analysis of what you need. So if you're able to calculate the time period of the spaceship, how will you do it? Let's draw a diagram and see. How will you calculate the time period of the spaceship? Varun, what you told is right. Can you tell me the formula alone?
Sir, so first, sir, we have to calculate the velocity now.
Yes. So the diagram is RE plus H. So tell me, you told me something related to centripetal force, no? M into V
sir,
square.
So MV square divided by RE plus H.
Very good.
Equal to G into M into capital M divided by RE plus H whole square.
They didn't speak about the, okay. They didn't say it's Earth, it is the mass of the planet divided by, so it is radius of the planet only. Rp plus Hd whole
square,
right? So this and this will get cancelled, small m is gone. So V is equal to root of G into mass of the planet divided by Re plus H the whole square. See, this is the reason I told you problem is not simple. Conceptually, it is simple only, but calculations get involved. So when it comes to the exam, try to have it as the last preference to do. Whereas if it is a general value, you can still do it. Now, I will calculate the time period of this particular spaceship. How do I do it? That also you told me.
Sir, 2π into Re plus H.
Very good. 2π into Rp plus H divided by the velocity. That is root of Gmp divided by Re plus H. Sorry, it is Rp plus H and there is no square actually. Correct? So it will be 2π divided by root of Gmp into Rp plus H the whole power 3/2. Okay, this is the time period. So once you calculate this value by substituting all the numbers that they have given, you will get a value. Let's say you are getting this as x. Then how to calculate the number of revolutions? It will be 24 hours divided by the value of x, provided this is also in terms of hours. If you do that, you will be able to get the required answer. Guys, are you able to understand the logic?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is the output. Make a note. Okay, shall I move on to the next one? These kind of problems you can have as the first preference, whichever is in general value. So let's do this. There is a solid sphere of mass small m and radius a is surrounded by a concentric spherical shell of thickness 2a and 2m. The gravitational field at a distance 3a from the center will be. So there is a solid sphere of mass capital M and radius a, which is surrounded by uniform concentric spherical shell of thickness 2a. Of thickness 2a and 2m, the gravitational field at a distance 3a from the center will be. How to do, guys? Anyone who can tell me? You have a sphere. Of radius a. And its mass is m. So understand here, how many objects are there in your hand? You have a solid sphere and you have a spherical shell. They both are different. Next. It is surrounded by a spherical shell. Do you guys remember the concept of solid sphere and spherical shell from electrostatics? Only if you remember that, I can proceed with this problem. Do you guys remember it?
Yes.
Okay. Then it's fine. Let's see. So this is the solid sphere. And this is the spherical shell. The gravitational field at a distance of how much value? At a distance 3a from it will be how much? Now tell me one thing. Due to solid sphere. Okay, when I say a solid sphere, is we can treat it like its whole mass is concentrated at the center. And if I treat it as a point mass, what is going to be the gravitational field at point P? So if I call solid sphere as 1, what is the gravitational field due to the solid sphere at point P? Can you tell me?
Gm by R square. R, A square.
But what is the distance?
3A the whole square.
It is 3a the whole square. That is right. So gm divided by 9a square. Then what can you say about a spherical shell? So for a spherical shell, when you're calculating the field outside, okay, I'm repeating it. When you're calculating the field outside it, then what is going to be the formula? G into That's why I asked, do you guys remember the electrostatic field concept?
4 pi r square.
4 pi or rather, there is no 4 pi at all. See, when I talk about a spherical shell, when you're... Do you guys remember there are three derivations? One is you will calculate the electric field inside, which will be zero for a conductor. But here it will be different, that I'll tell you later. So electric field inside will be zero, on the surface will be gm by r square, and outside will be gm divided by small r square, where r is the distance from the center to the point. That is, a spherical shell will behave like a point object here also. So g into, what should I write in the place of m?
2m.
Yes, 2m divided by 3a the whole square. That is 2gm divided by 9a square. Now what is going to be the net? Be 3gm divided by 9a square, that will be gm divided by 3a square. Is there an option?
C, sir.
Right. But you have to be very careful when this problem comes for a distance which is less than a or less than 2a. You need to be very careful. Okay. Anyways, I'll try to find the problem of that sort and explain it to you. But is this problem clear? This is a simple one, actually. Nothing so tough about it. But one thing you have to remember is wherever you see a spherical shell, whether it is electrostatics or gravitational field, when you calculate it at a point P, which is outside it, then the spherical shell can be treated as a point mass where the whole mass is concentrated at its center. Yes, right, guys? Are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll do one last problem. So rocket has to be launched from Earth in such a way that it never returns. Means it's imparted. It's imparted escape velocity. So rocket has to be launched from Earth in such a way that it never returns. If E is the minimum energy delivered by the rocket launcher, what should be the minimum energy that the launcher should have if the same rocket is to be launched from the surface of the moon? Assume that the density of the Earth and the moon are equal and the Earth's volume is 64 times the volume of the moon. So how to do this, guys? So what are the given data? So they have told the density of Earth is equal to density of Moon. Next. They have told volume of Earth is 64 times the volume of Moon. So ME divided by 4
pi. The mass of Earth is...
Yeah.
Tell me. 64 times the mass of the Moon.
You cannot say 64 times no, because if the radius is not linearly proportional, it is proportional cubic times. Oh, you took it like this. Okay. ME divided by the volume of Earth is equal to 64 times volume of Moon. So it is 64 times volume of Moon is equal to volume of, so this is, yes, that's right, I'm sorry. So mass of Earth is equal to 64 times mass of Moon. Okay, then what else are we supposed to do? Since they are talking about energy, what energy are they trying to talk about? So what are the minimum energy that we need to give on the surface of the Earth?
Kinetic energy.
Yes, kinetic energy, or and the kinetic energy is actually equal to what energy? We got this, no? Half into m into v square is equal potential. To g m into, it is equal to the potential energy. So can I say energy on the Earth divided by energy on the Moon is equal to g into mass of the rocket into mass of Earth divided by radius of Earth divided by g into mass of the rocket into mass of Moon divided by the radius of Moon. So g, this and this will get cancelled. So mass of Earth divided by radius of Earth into radius of Moon divided by the mass of Moon. Guys, are you able to understand? So mass of Earth divided by mass of Moon is 64 into, what can you say about the radius of Moon and the radius of Earth? That we can calculate from here, 4 by 3 pi re cube is equal to 64 into 4 by 3 pi rm cube. So this and this will get cancelled. What is the value of re? Re will be 4 times rm. So re by rm will be 1 by 4 and rm will, by re will be 1/4. So 64 divided by 4 will give you a 16. So energy on the surface of the Earth is E divided by energy on the moon is equal to 16, which implies energy to be given on the moon is E divided by 16. Guys, are you able to understand?
Yes, sir.
So you need to give 1/16 of the energy that you actually gave on the surface of the Earth. So this problem is actually about manipulation. It's calculations. Nothing to do with concept. Only concept you're supposed to know is the energy to be imparted from the surface is nothing but the gravitational potential energy. Clear? So this is all for today. Just wait for a minute.